People in Taiwan, since childhood, have been told never to forget how much toil goes into every grain of rice. There were times when Taiwan relied on the export of cane sugar, bananas, and canned pineapples for foreign exchange. To be sure, Taiwan's agriculture has undergone tremendous changes over the past century. No longer meant merely for feeding people, rice now comes under the spotlight in competitive events and becomes a favorite choice for visiting gifts. No longer engaged in farming, thousands of rural households have now become part of the recreation industry. But there's no forgetting the hard work of our forefathers that has made possible what we are today. Their dedication and diligence figures prominently in many an exciting tale of Taiwan's agriculture. In July 2010, a news story moved many people. Grandpa Liang, 75, had to give away his old ox because of his own old age. Like giving away his own daughter, he sent it to an institution intended specifically for the care of old farm cattle in Tainan County. The ox, perhaps sensing the imminent parting, ate and drank nothing for days. Silently, the ox kept its master company during these last few days as their time together was about to end. Diligence is a virtue shared by the people and farm cattle of Taiwan. Here, like a family, man and his cattle endure hardships and enjoy harvest together. In awe of heaven and earth, they are content and have a positive outlook on life. Over the past century, Taiwan has been able to feed an ever-expanding population. And no matter how the world has changed, people keep up a simple and profound affinity for cattle. Tales of man and his cattle in times of hardship, like the one just told, appeal to people because they speak not only of appreciation and gratitude, but also of the courage to adapt to changing times. Early in the 20th century, when Taiwan was still a Japanese colony, its economy was dominated by rice and sugar. As Japan consumed much white sugar, the Taiwan Governor General's office did its best to promote the cane sugar industry. Its various incentives proved effective in luring Japanese conglomerates to set up shop in Taiwan. Because of this aggressive initiative, sugarcane took up as much as one-third of the island's arable land. Likewise, the Japanese sought to have Taiwan help meet their demand for rice. At Juzhou Yangmingshan, Professor Iso Eikichi succeeded in breeding a new variety out of Taiwan's indigenous indica rice. Tasty and al dente, this new rice came to be known as Honglai rice. Back then, it was meant almost exclusively for export to Japan. Agriculture can never do without water supplies. The Jiangnan irrigation system, undertaken by the Japanese technician Yoichi Hata, was the largest of its kind in Asia at that time. It did not only enable more rice paddies to grow a second crop, but relieve the Jiangnan plain of three nuisances all at once: floods, droughts, and intrusion of sea salt. The harvests of Honglai rice soared in both quantity and quality accordingly. Combined, the improvement in rice breeding and construction of irrigation infrastructure changed Taiwan's agricultural landscape dramatically. The previous focus only on cane sugar was supplemented by an equal emphasis on rice as well. The Second World War ended with the defeat of Japan in 1945. Taiwan's restoration also meant the start of post-war reconstruction. But soon, with the nationalist government's retreat from mainland China, it had to deal with a gigantic increase in demand for foods. To resolve this food shortage, the nationalist government introduced a string of land reform initiatives: farmland rent reduction to 37.5%, sale of public land, and land to the tiller. These programs proved a success as farmers had a stronger incentive to grow crops. In turn, unit output increased substantially. Tenant farmers became farmland owners, and family-sized farms became the norm across Taiwan's rural villages. Meeting the demand for food was an urgent priority in post-war Taiwan. Li Lianchun, the third director of the Taiwan Provincial Food Bureau, first surveyed the rice output in different parts of the island. By implementing a rice fertilizer barter program and the paddy tax paid in kind, his agency was able to get better hold of supplies and pile up reserves. Public demand was met and the price of rice could be kept stable as well. In those days, increasing production was a national craze. Rice output rose to record highs and could even generate foreign exchange income to construct the Baihe and Zhengwen reservoirs. Meanwhile, Taiwan became the world's third largest white sugar exporter, a position that would be retained for a full decade. Rice and sugar both became primary sources of Taiwan's foreign exchange income. In addition to rice and sugar, Taiwan also scored admirably in shipping abroad other agricultural products during the two decades after the war. Taiwan was given the title of Kingdom of Bananas, as it once took as much as 90% of the Japanese market. Taiwan was also the number one supplier of canned mushrooms, whose exports once hit $100 million a year, as well as canned asparagus. Together with canned pineapples, they were Taiwan's most important processed agricultural products meant for export in those years. After its relocation to Taiwan, the Sino-American Joint Commission on Rural Reconstruction, or JCRR, took advantage of American aid in strengthening rural development, improving education, and upgrading technical competence. It had a decisive influence on the reconstruction and subsequent development of Taiwan's agriculture. In the 1950s, the JCRR introduced the Mary Tiller from Japan for experiments and demonstrations at the various agricultural research and extension stations. The government also tried something new in propaganda. Central Pictures Corporation was entrusted to make a documentary film depicting how a young girl learns tiller steering and takes up farming on behalf of her father. To promote the benefits of farm machines replacing human labor, the Food Bureau also held a contest of tiller steering, contested by both men and women. All these efforts led to a rapid increase in the procurement of small tillers among farmers. In turn, Taiwan's agriculture gradually moved toward a new era of mechanization. Soon enough, the post-war years saw agriculture recover and become capable of supporting industry. But rapid economic development also lured a growing number of young people away from rural communities to cities. Taking notice of the decline in agricultural labor, the government stepped up the drive toward mechanization and offered low-interest loans. It also formed contract farming teams across the country to help farmers short of farmhands. Chen Jiangnan, a contract farmer in Ilan, used to be a research assistant at the Department of Horticulture, National Taiwan University. It was a stable job, but he chose to become a specialized operator of farm machinery instead. Returning to his hometown Ilan, Chen Jiangnan bought tillage machinery with a low-interest loan from the government. Business coming his way was almost too much for him to handle.
算起来的话，一年营收哈，大概在差不多两百万左右吧，哈，那个时候一甲地差不多也在两百万。Ilan
is fertile ground for contract farming, as it has always relied heavily on growing rice. As such, Chen Jiangnan has now been joined by his children and grandchildren in helping the development of local agriculture. Rapid economic development of the 1970s caused even more drastic changes in the way of life and in business model across rural communities. Structural adjustment across agriculture became a necessity. Raising hogs was no longer a sideline, but a specialized business that soon expanded to export markets. Both animal husbandry and deep-sea fishery became export industries. In 1972, then-premier Zhang Jinghuo implemented a program designed to speed up agricultural development and ease burdens on farmers. The rice fertilizer barter program was abolished, resulting in a substantial decrease in the amount of public stock rice. But the world was hit by a widespread food shortage the following year. The domestic price of rice surged as the government simply did not have sufficient means to cushion the rise. This experience inspired the establishment in 1974 of a 3 billion NT-dollar food stabilization fund to purchase paddy rice at guaranteed prices. The initiative, however, also led to an oversupply of rice. The government had no choice but to export the surplus rice. It began encouraging farmers to shift to growing other food grains or other crops of higher economic value. While increasing the quantities of crops is no longer a key objective today, food security remains crucial to national stability. All these sacks of grains have been bought from farmers at guaranteed prices. Each sack is public property that can help stabilize consumer prices when necessary. Public stock rice procurement, first initiated 37 years ago, underwent a major change from the second crop season of 2011. Farmers can now sell their wet rice grains to the state by turning them over to contracted operators who own drying equipment. This more convenient approach also helps ensure farmers' income. In the 1980s, liberalization of the world economy accelerated. The government responded to this calling virtually in every sector by easing market controls, cutting tariffs, and removing restrictions over imports. In the spring of 1988, the announcement on expanding agricultural imports instantly triggered suspicion and even panic among farmers. They took to the streets on May 20th. It was the largest farmer protest in post-war Taiwan. Market opening pressures mounted further. The heightened awareness among farmers had to be taken seriously. In 1989, the government launched health insurance for farmers, reduced fertilizer prices, and raised the guaranteed price for rice procurement. These were followed by the launch of welfare allowances for elderly farmers in 1995. Meanwhile, innovative forms of agriculture began to appear. Tourist orchards, for example, became a fad. Picking strawberries and other fruits became a popular pastime. Another battle, however, seemed inevitable, even as Taiwan was working to transform its agriculture and make it more competitive.
Ministerial conference, so agree.
In 2002, after exchanges of numerous proposals and counter-proposals on the negotiating table, Taiwan's delegates got what they had long wanted, Taiwan's admission into the WTO. but it also meant a heavy blow to agriculture. Joining the WTO was meant to bolster the national economy, but agricultural liberalization needed time. In the marathon of admission talks, Taiwan's delegates took every step cautiously because they also had to choose between gives and takes. As director of the Planning Department, Council of Agriculture, Chen Wuxiong was Taiwan's chief negotiator in farm talks. His poem offers an emotional reminiscence.
25个国家连声的恭贺，突破了被封锁的视线，弥补了被孤立的尊严。五个木锤声，等了12年，敲下了日夜的弦念，一锤一大步。
The road to success was never easy. Admission into the WTO inevitably had a great impact on industry, but it also offered impetus to agricultural innovation. It set the stage for a new beginning. Thanks to the concerted efforts of all quarters concerned, Taiwan's seemingly fragile agriculture proved incredibly resilient. At such a critical juncture, farmers, research institutions, and government agencies had the consensus that change and innovation was the only way to manage the crisis favorably. Research institutions were always trying to improve breeds and innovate cultivation techniques. They were often rewarded with major breakthroughs. Take rice, for example. In 1992, Dr. Guo Yiquan and his team developed a new breed of aromatic rice after a decade of breed selection and crossbreeding. Dr. Lai Ming-xian is a member of the team who played a key role in the latter half of the project. He witnessed how a new milestone was erected.
I was from the University of Washington from Georgia. When I first thought that in the international market, there is a smell of rice that is almost double. So he thought, let's do a smell and 我们就开始找亲本，然后做一些组合。每一年这样反反复复一直选拔，以后在89年就提出命名。But
regrettably, Dr. Guo broke down from constant overwork and died just 2 months before the new aromatic rice was to be presented to the world. To commemorate this scientist who devoted a lifetime to Taiwan's rice farming, the new breed was named Yiquan Aromatic Rice.
以往的台湾百年的水稻育成的品种超过300个，没有一个品种有商业名称。这一个台农70要一拳香米，这是第一个有商业名称的品种，这是莫大的荣誉。But
the promotion and trial planting of Yiquan Aromatic Rice got off to a bumpy start. Rice grass would begin to tilt just when rice grains started to get firm. What followed was a universal collapse all around. Researchers came under incredible pressure to figure out why. It turned out that a precondition to growing Yiquan aromatic rice was lesser use of nitrogen fertilizer. But local farmers had long been accustomed to using it excessively. Dramatically greater output was often accompanied by the massive collapse of rice grass.
我们面对的是一个栽种已经三四十年 甚至有的五六十年的族群，这一些人讲实在话，吃过盐都比我吃过米较济啊。所以我当初在推广的时候，一上台话都还没有讲了，下面就说啊，这边听这边听，这菜叫呢，捌得啥？哦，就掉头就走。哎，这个其实哦，对我们这个来讲哦，是很大的伤害哦。可是你为了这个品种的推广，你还是要拉下脸来跟他讲，希望说他在肥料的施用上能够特别注意。
The perseverance was not in vain. Farmers saw their revenue jump 30% after adjusting their use of fertilizer. Yichuan aromatic rice proved a hit. Vendors were happy to see many repeat customers. Devoting years of hard work in their lab, researchers contributed a proud new chapter to Taiwan's rice history. Meanwhile, people began to ponder whether rice, the long-standing staple, has more to offer other than merely feeding the populace. Various competitions were thus started nationwide to pick all sorts of champion rice. Moreover, creative packaging that highlights local characteristics also helped create new markets. Today, rice is widely regarded as an excellent gift item. Exquisite small packs of rice are a symbol of fashion. Quality is now considered everything. Not only are agricultural products increasingly refined, but farm organizations have also been revamped. Over the past century, farmers' associations have been closest to farmers and have assisted the government in carrying out its policy. In Taiwan, farmers' associations provide every service imaginable to rural villages, promoting new farming techniques, extending loans, and procuring crops for the state. What should farmers grow? How to grow and sell it? Want to build a new house, prepare for your son's wedding, or pay for your children's tuition? The farmers' association may just have the answers, but even farmers' associations need to change with the times. In recent years, farmers' associations nationwide have presented various products, ushering in a new blue ocean market for agricultural products as gifts, many adding value via farm-brewed wines and liqueurs. Farmers' associations have also been bold to try unconventional marketing tactics. The Xinyi Farmers' Association of Nantou County, for instance, has won a string of accolades for its ingenuity. Its fame spread all over Taiwan when Ma La Sun became a household name. In the movie Cape No. 7, Ma La Sun is a salesman pitching millet wine made by the Xinyi Farmers Association. He says, a thousand-year heritage, a new sensation, which also illustrates how farmers' associations of today have been rewarded for striking a balance between seeking innovation and preserving tradition. This balance has been achieved on the path toward building new brand names in a long-standing conventional industry. In Taiwan, farmers' associations are relatively small but strong entities. The trust earned among farmers helps form a solid interpersonal network, a key foundation that ensures the stability of rural communities. They have been and will remain an indispensable instrument in implementing agricultural policy. Agriculture is what a people relies on for subsistence. Most farm products are eventually meant for the dining table. How can we be sure that what we eat is healthy and safe? It is essential to have a management mechanism that ensures this. Good agriculture practice, organic agriculture, certified agricultural standards, and food traceability are among the most important undertakings in this respect. The label of good agriculture practice, or GAP, was introduced in 1994 as a certificate of fruits and vegetables being free from pesticide residue. The Taiwan Agricultural Chemicals and Toxic Substances Research Institute is responsible for making sure that foods on our table are safe and healthy. The various certificates and labels make it much easier for consumers to buy agricultural products of their choice. Thanks to these labels of safety, fruits become a hot commodity. Orchards for export are thus designated, as they are supposed to enforce even tighter control over the quality and chemical safety of their fruits. In order to be accepted in overseas markets, they will have to conform to international standards of certification. Lin Jianyi has also joined the cause. Like many other farmers working hard in this field, he is selling fruits not only in Taiwan, but to Japan, Korea, and mainland China. He earns not only profits for himself, but also pride for his country. In the evolution of agriculture, many long-standing elements have given way to one innovation after another. Innovation easily sets in alongside a steady increase in the standards of living. Many crops are no longer meant merely for feeding people. It is now an era of new industries, new technologies, and new markets. As living standards improve and market demand increases, growing flowers readily becomes a sunrise industry. As such, the government and the private sector have joined forces in transforming it into a high-tech brand of modern enterprise. Also coming into existence is a highly efficient market for auctioning flowers. As early as the 1980s, Taiwan began making inroads into the Japanese flower market. Its cut flowers of chrysanthemum and gladiolus soon dominated Japanese imports. Later, Oncidium grabbed the spotlight. It has topped the list of Taiwan's exports of cut flowers in recent years. This performance is no less dazzling than its beauty. The key to enabling Oncidium to emerge triumphantly in a fiercely contested flower market is technological advancement. In the early days of Oncidium exports, as many as 9 million stalks of fresh-cut flowers were shipped. But a bottleneck soon appeared, as the lack of reliable post-harvest technology could not ensure quality during long-distance transportation. To solve this problem, Dr. Huang Jiaojia of the Taiwan Agricultural Research Institute developed a technology that could keep the flowers fresh in storage and transportation. Their shipping was no longer a problem, as they could now enjoy a longer lifespan in the vase. The timely application of advances in agricultural science and technology to mass production has further bolstered the premium standing of Taiwan's Oncidium in the fresh-cut flowers market. Thanks to this new technology, it is now possible to ship fresh-cut flowers of Oncidium in large quantities, even in summer. With export costs largely curtailed, Taiwan emerged the world's largest producer of these cut flowers at one time, and accounted for more than 90% of Japanese flower imports. Ventures that specialize in packaging of cut flowers also deserve credit. Coupled with up-to-date marketing techniques, their centralized operations from grading and selection to final packaging enable the many Oncidium production and marketing groups in Taiwan to jointly pry open a new blue ocean. From family-sized businesses to cross-border ventures, Taiwan's phalaenopsis industry has also grown substantially over the past three decades. Take root in Taiwan, but bloom all over the world. Today, Taiwan controls more than half of the world's phalaenopsis genetic resources and 40% of the core production technologies. Propelled by continuous innovative R&D, massive amounts of quality phalaenopsis are exported to Japan, the US, and Europe, and it is now the only country permitted to ship phalaenopsis with growth media attached to the US, New Zealand, and Australia. In 2011, phalaenopsis exports topped $3 billion NT dollars. To be sure, phalaenopsis is now one of Taiwan's primary agricultural exports, and Taiwan is known as the Kingdom of Phalaenopsis.
兰花在这十年来一个变化，整个产业能够走得这么样的一个发达，其实有三个部分是相当重要的。政府的政策下的跟产业需求这一些学术研究单位的开发的一些技术，跟产业的这方面的需求都有达到一个很密切的一个关系，这样才能够有这样的一个成绩上的一个表现。In
2011, Taiwan won a gold medal at the Chelsea Flower Show, organized by the Royal Horticultural Society in London. What's more, Queen Elizabeth II stopped at Taiwan's booth and accepted a new breed of phalaenopsis named after her. The Queen's praise of Taiwan's ingenuity in floral art was surely a welcome affirmation of its prestigious standing in the international flower industry. In growing Oncidium and phalaenopsis, Taiwan has scored exemplary success in applying science and technology to agriculture. But agriculture is always subjugated to the forces of nature. As climate change persists, the intensity and frequency of natural disasters has also increased. Conventional farming must have a tough time in adapting to this transitional period. But the resilience of Taiwan's agriculture has also asserted itself more strongly at this juncture. Farmers never easily give up. Because of this spirit, Taiwan's agriculture can always start over after sustaining one natural disaster after another. The September 21 earthquake of 1999 sent shockwaves across Taiwan. Mountains in central Taiwan were hit hardest, as the disaster even changed their landforms. Post-quake reconstruction also changed many farmers' way of life and thinking. Take black tea. Because it had been chosen as a tribute to the emperor during Japanese colonial rule, the black tea of Yuchir Township, Nantou County, could be sold abroad at a hefty price. Its heyday persisted for more than three decades. But things started to change in the 1980s. Rapid economic development drove labor costs higher. Local farmers began using inexpensive tea leaves of lesser quality as a substitute to compete with foreign rivals. This quickly eroded the glory of Yuchir, which finally became a bygone few remember. But the black tea of Yuchir still held the promise of resurgence. Three months before the devastating earthquake of 1999, TTES number 18, a new tea developed by the Taiwan Tea Experiment Station of the Council of Agriculture, secured approval for bringing to market. Better known as Ruby, it is a precious hybrid of Myanmar's large-leaved black tea and Taiwan's wild camellia. It had taken more than half a century's experiments. Farmers hesitated at first, but the earthquake helped convince them.
宜池也是一个蛮重大的灾区。宜池的红茶呢，在从日据时代就相当相当的有名了，因此呢，我们就选择这个红茶作为我们一个农业复兴的产物出来。
Tea has long been a major agricultural product in Taiwan. Best known are Tie Guanyin tea and Baozhong tea in northern Taiwan, White Tip Oolong tea in Taoyuan, Hsinchu, and Miaoli, and Dongding Oolong tea and Alpine tea in central and southern Taiwan. Also catching up fast is black tea. TTES number 18 is now known as the Black Tea of Yuchir. Thanks to specialized guidance, branding, and packaging, and a general improvement of business conditions, the ugly duckling of yesterday is now a beautiful swan. A once discarded industry is now a source of pride again. Tea farmers are increasingly joined by their children in resuming cultivation and renovating equipment. Ye Jinlong, who heads the tea production and marketing group at Xianjia Jiao, is a key figure in restoring the glory of Yuchir black tea. He and Chiu Chui Fong from the Tea Research and Extension Station had many discussions. They agreed on the need to grow quality black tea by doing without pesticide and chemical fertilizer. Their decision was rewarded generously. future prospers as its black tea sells like a hot potato. Such a dramatic turn of events only serves to highlight the vicissitudes of life. The perseverance of local farmers is an inherent inclination not to give up. The tougher the situation becomes, the more determined they are to find a way out. The 1999 earthquake led to a massive wave of reconstruction across rural communities in central mountain areas. People not only rebuilt their homes, but also readjusted their way of life. The Soshui community of Dian Village at Yuchi and the Taomi Eco-Village of Puli have now become tourist spots with fame extending abroad. In similar communities all over Taiwan, locals can fully bring out their respective characteristics. In 2010, the government introduced a rural regeneration initiative. Residents of rural communities build consensus on how to make their home a better place that takes account of industry, culture, and ecology. It is a peaceful revolution, a revival of rural communities that aims to increase their quality of living. At Nanpu Village in Beifu Township, Hsinchu County, one can see in the midst of rice paddies an old ditch and an ancient water wheel built more than 100 years ago. Mr. Chun inherits the family occupation of farming from his father and grandfather. The water wheel they left behind is still standing and continues to supply water from the ditch to the paddies. After the 1999 earthquake, water in the ditches of Beipu Township began to thin out gradually. Villagers were quite worried that their own would soon dry up. Some proposed fallow to get the water back to the ditch, but fallow would be a costly decision for the people of Beipu, who rely heavily on their farmland. Was it possible? Several discussions led to a quite different conclusion. Villagers agreed to do emergency repairs instead. In the upper stretch of the ditch, 21 tunnels had fallen into disrepair. Many collapses in the wake of the earthquake had left the waterway blocked. No one knew what to do. Finally, four old farmers who had grown up together in the village decided to take the job. Combined, they were more than 300 years old.
没有水，就是没有可以生存了。The
old farmers and other villagers worked for 2 months. The 2-kilometer-long ditch was finally cleared up. Water returned. Banding together, the farmers of Nanpu Village returned to their rice paddies, an indispensable resource that they had almost lost once. Repairing the century-old ditch is an act of great significance. It has not only reinvigorated local farming, but also reaffirmed the community's vitality and unity. In former times, rural villages were often associated with senility and weakness. Now, many youth have chosen to return to their villages. They have the daring and passion to apply new concepts and knowledge while also picking up the experience and spirit of their elders. Their innovativeness is often rewarded aplenty.
我原来的背景是念材料光电的，那加入这个农事主要是因为家族从事农业，再加上在我退伍的时候，政府推出了小地主大佃农的政策，所以在这两个因素综合之下，我踏进了这个产业。
Under the Small Landlords Big Tenants Program, The government encourages old farmers to rent their land on a long-term basis to young farmers eager to expand, so that they can become a big tenant farmer like Su Jianjun. The initiative is meant to make farming more appealing. Old farmers can thus enjoy reasonable fixed income after retirement, while young farmers full of vitality can have more opportunity to apply their diligence in the fields. The Shanhua Food Grains Cooperative in Tainan engages in contract farming and management of such crops as corn and edamame. By soliciting the participation of youth and equipping them with the needed knowledge and skills, it aims to maximize its scale of production and thus make sure that farming can also become an occupation with stable income.
我们现在所承租的农地大概是八十公顷，大概是一间高雄大学的大小，或者比拟成八个台中高铁站的大小。那我们总租金一年大约是在350万左右，基本上我们就会以薄利多销的角度来操作。我们每一个利润都很薄，但是我们量够大的话，其实是有机会回本的。The
small landlord's big tenants program is just part of a broader initiative to better adapt to local agriculture's demographic realities. Likewise, the Farmers Academy was established to offer systematic training in order to enhance the quality of the agricultural workforce. The infusion of young blood allows old farmers to retire with dignity and enjoy life no longer weighed down by work in the fields. The Farmers Academy gives the community a new vitality.
大家都不会了，而且大家心情都特别高兴，特别快乐。虽然吼，同学拢总足好啦，啊，咱跳了吼，心情也好啦，哦，啊，咱啊真快乐安尼啦。
It is not only rural communities that need the infusion of fresh blood. Agriculture itself must move to the next level and make a tertiary industry. It needs to make eco-friendliness take root in rural villages and place equal emphasis on production and environmental protection. It needs to ensure the sustainable coexistence of man and land. Only then can it break away from conventional restraints and emerge a competitive industry capable of creating added value. Sometimes chance may offer an auspicious start from which the joint efforts of people work wonders. 60 Stone Mountain is now a famous tourist spot in Hualien. Between early August and late September, visitors enjoy seas of daylily flowers in full bloom. But this enchanting beauty had a not-so-romantic origin. Daylily flowers are no longer good for harvesting the instant they begin to blossom. After Taiwan lifted the ban on daylily imports, local growers had no choice but to give it up as their costs were simply too high. Resigned, farmers just left their blossoming daylilies in the mountain. But the crisis led to a dramatic turn of events. Today, farmers will deliberately allow their daylilies to blossom in order to attract crowds of sightseers. As such, daylily growing is now a sunrise industry rather than a sunset industry. Farmers have once again found a way out.
游客变多了以后，那山上的农民他去做竞争加工，他可以把这竞争卖给我们山上的民宿业者。
In the old days, seas of flowers were worthless. Agriculture meant production. But now things are different. Today's agriculture has ample space for aesthetics and creativity. Rural communities can develop an appeal uniquely their own, thereby making themselves that much more attractive to city dwellers. They can preserve their heritage even as they introduce new elements. Today's agriculture has been redefined to include ensuring food safety, protecting the nation's land against both natural disasters and damage caused by man, and preserving rural culture. Agriculture has left behind many memorable footmarks over the past century. Forefathers have passed on the wisdom of being grateful for what one has been blessed with. From the birth of Penglai rice to the craze to serve the nation by increasing output, from the transformation of Taiwan's agricultural society to the revival of rice as a major dietary choice. We have seen the emergence of a new agriculture. We have both the capability and the courage to watch over our homeland. We believe many more exciting tales of Taiwan's agriculture have yet to be written and told. They will add to a proud history marked by both inheritance and innovation, and to be passed on to future generations.